I think the greatest title I could give myself is probably creative entrepreneur, because I would basically say I'm always hustling in some creative endeavor, and that has pretty much been my life since I was 15 years old.
How did you start as a writer?
As a writer, actually, I started writing music as a mode of survival. So I bought a $50 guitar from a friend when I was 18, went and worked at a Salvation Army camp in Malibu Canyon, Calabasas, for like 300 inner city kids for, it was a Salvation Army camp. And 2 weeks into the camp, the guy who was the worship leader left in the middle of the night and basically left a note that said, "This place sucks." And he like went home, and they're like, "Okay, cool. Like, who here can lead worship here? Who has a guitar, can sing?" And it was lined up so that I was the only guy that had a guitar and played it at all. So I knew two chords. I knew D and G, and not good. And I was the new worship leader for 300 kids, plus, you know, all the counselors. And I just had to make stuff up on the spot, because I didn't have enough chords to play anybody else's songs. So it took me the rest of the summer to start getting fluent, but almost immediately I was writing off the cuff. Like, what two chords and what rhythms can I bang out, and what lyrics or what can I say or sing over this that will be relevant and engaging for 300 6-year-old to 14-year-olds. And that was how I started writing, like literally for survival. Like,
how long did it take you to write your first song?
I would say, honestly, like, that's the hard part, is when is it a song? You know what I mean? Like, at what point does it become, like, we have these weird ways of defining when it becomes a song. So I had what is Bob Dylan says? I think it's Bob Dylan who said, "Give me four chords in the truth and I'll change the world." And it's like, realistically, I only had a few lines, but I had two chords and some lines, and these kids were singing along. So to me, that's a song. So I would say within a few days. But by the technical term of, did it have a verse and a chorus, and I laid it down and, you know, made a demo track of it, you know, 6 or 8 months, you know? So it just depends on the definition.
Is the song ever finished?
That's the hard part, is like, let's just take like a song that I've been known for, like the anthem, for years and years. Wake up, child, it's your turn to shine. You were born for such a time as this, such a time as this. Well, I still continue to change it. So like every time I play it live, I like add to it, play the chords differently. I do like different builds. You never know what version I'm gonna give you. Like when I show up to lead at something, I'm definitely not gonna give you the recorded version. So it just depends on what happens. I mean, half the time I'm playing, I end the song by singing the I Am Royalty portion over, you know, Rage Against the Machine, Killing in the Name of riff. So it's like, you know, is it ever done? Sure, because it goes into history as a, you know, a product. But at the end of the day, as an artist, like, that's the beautiful part about music. It depends on how you're feeling that day.
Take us inside a healthy writing session. What does that look like?
I think the healthiest write. So let's go with the most awful things you could do in a session where you're writing with other individuals. Sarcasm, joking, any type of like, the hard part is like, you know, sometimes our insecurities allow us to make statements, or jealousies or envy allow us to make statements in a room with a bunch of artists that will absolutely stifle and limit creativity every single time. We think we're being funny, but we don't realize that we have no idea what hurts or wounds the people in that room are carrying. That's going to then cause them to believe that they're no longer safe in that space. So the first thing we should get rid of is any sort of like, let's just get rid of the sarcasm. If you're gonna bring it into the room, and if it's gonna show up in the room, like, who's leading this space? So like on the healthy side, you can't show up into a group of people and go, "Hey, we're all here, we're all equals, we're just gonna write together." Who's actually in charge? because a room full of peers trying to write a song together where nobody gets the final call is never going to be healthy, because somebody's always going to feel like they got slighted or that other people were preferred. I guess what I would say is, like, in order to minimize that or limit that, we can actually just get dads in the room, which make it really healthy. Dads or moms in that space that ultimately get the final say and ultimately get control of that room. So that way, if some sarcasm or some joking shows up that could be minimizing or feel hurtful, that person can cut it off immediately. And I've watched this happen in writing sessions and in rooms with artists consistently, like even with guys that would be considered dads, and they like make a joke like, you're the whatever, off the cuff. And it just, I don't think very many people pay attention to the fact that that's it. You're going to get some ideas out, but they're not going to be the best ones. Because really the best ideas require such an immense amount of vulnerability, like that if that room's not safe, you'll get a good chorus, maybe you'll get a hook, but it won't be the best. It won't be the good stuff that's really buried deep in the human soul, in the midst of someone's story that requires days, weeks, months, years of trust building in order to get to it. And I think that's where some of the best songs are written. In rooms like where the people in the room have been friends for years. That is life-changing. You know, when you're sitting in a room and someone can say, that's not good, but keep going down that road. Like, follow that. And you're not like, it's not good, because you've been with the person for 5-10 years. You know, I'll pass my stuff by my wife. Like, dude, she'll be the first person to be like, that song sucks. She'll be like, that melody's dumb and those lyrics are lame. They're cheesy. And I'm like, wow, I thought they were like really profound. But because we have 20 years of marriage, the moment she goes, that's not good, I go, okay, what part stands out as not good? Is it this phrase or is it this? You know? And to have that in a writing session, dude, like, that's why we need community that's like not just business. Like, if it's just business, crap idea, good idea, crap idea, good idea, you'll get good stuff, but you won't get that culture shifting, atmosphere shaking stuff that is like magic. Never, it just rarely happens.
Tagging back to the song, The Anthem, yeah. When you wrote it, did you know what it was going to become?
So The Anthem was written, I still have the original CD, because we used to record them onto CDs, because I basically ran a house of prayer for 3 years. We did like 24/7 for 3 years, and I would record every session. And I do all my songwriting in the midst of, like, let me say it this way. I write all my worship songs, all the songs that are like corporate worship songs, I always write on a platform while I'm leading worship. So like, that's how I've done it since day one. Just whatever comes out in the atmosphere, I'm gonna sing. And I would lead worship for 6 to 8 hours a day in the house of prayer. Like, I would just be there till my fingers bleed. A lot of people joke because I'm like, you know, changing strings while I'm still leading worship sometimes, you know, where other people have like a few guitars. I just change a string, keep singing, because I've like literally done it that way for so long. And with The Anthem, we were doing just another prayer meeting. We were praying from Esther, you know, perhaps you were born for such a time as this. So I started singing a little bit of chorus, then started singing I Am Royalty, then kind of, we sang it, the CD that we recorded in the midst of that moment, because we were just recording everything, just in case something good came out, I could take it, put it on my computer, and then chop it up. And we sang it, and it was not a big deal. Like, cool. Like, yeah, I'll record that. I'll throw it on a little demo CD, not a big deal. We're praying for Esther. We read the word, pray the word, sing the word. That was it. It was like, done, another song, move on. And I just would write tons. I mean, in those CDs, there's probably hundreds and hundreds of songs that'll never get sung by anyone. Why did that one get picked? Right time, right place? I don't know. Like, for me, and even the way it got heard, like, I write this song in a prayer meeting. Everyone's like, oh, that was a good one. We should hang on to that. Cool. So mark the CD. Boom. Months later, track it in my office. Done. Put it on a demo. banning Liebscher from Jesus Culture and Kim Walker were going to come down to like an event we were doing. Well, Banning flew out of one airport, Kim flew out of another. I wasn't supposed to lead worship at all, because why would I lead worship if Kim's coming? Like, that would just be dumb. And so I was like, cool, we got them all set up, got them a band. Everyone was stoked. Well, Kim's plane out of another airport got delayed for 4 hours. So Banning makes it, Kim doesn't. She's like, do you know anybody that leads worship that can fill the slot? Because nobody even knew I led worship, because I'm not leading worship at anything that all of our, all these people are at, because I'm just wanting to be around them. And so I'm like, dude, I got it. Don't worry. Just take your time. Come rest. My wife will pick you up at the airport. So I get the band ready, start leading these songs. Banning walks in halfway through the anthem and is like, this is pre-Jesus Culture music label. And he's like, that song we have to have. Like, can we record it? Can you, like, you need to be on our label. That doesn't exist. And I literally told him no. I was like, yeah, whatever. Like, yeah, you got a label. Everybody has a label, you know? And I was like, no, I'm good. 6 months later, he comes and meets us in San Diego. And like, we have a whole conversation. The rest is sort of like history. But it's like, I joke around with everyone, like, you don't know what your yes is going to lead to. Like, the goal isn't to like, in the most beautiful songs, like whether it's John Mark's How He Loves, like these sort of timeless songs, like the anthem was just used 2 nights ago for a championship UFC fight. Like the Brazilian guy that's like the, you know, lightweight champion, he walks out to the Portuguese version because it's been recorded in like 4 different languages. Like, it was written in a room with 3 people. There was no group of songwriters trying to craft anything. John Mark McMillan wasn't like crafting this thing when he was lamenting over his friend. I was just singing from scripture. You know, these timeless songs like that, I feel like they're more about just the yes in the moment than they are about the crafting of a thing. You know, songs that are timeless, they just come from a deep heart cry that has to be said. I needed to sing I Am Royalty because I didn't believe that's what I was. I didn't believe I had much value, you know? I'm in a little room. I didn't think my art was any good. And I needed to know that I had value before God and before others. That's what came out. And now it's being sung. Still, that song's, what, 12 years old? 13 years old now? Maybe more? And 2 nights ago, it's on, you know, pay-per-view. Stupid. A Portuguese version, you know? So it's all about that yes than it is about crafting the perfect thing, you know?
Is it difficult not to put those same expectations that you got from the anthem on to other songs?
I know it is for some people. I so love the process, I really don't care. Like, I just get that my music is weird. Like, it's like, I'm the guy you invite like once because you're like really going after something, but I don't get like the 20 invites, you know what I mean? Like the other worship leaders. I'm the guy you invite for a niche moment because Jake is going to just like come in and break stuff. So for me, I enjoy the journey of like crafting stuff. Like my wife calls it chasing butterflies. Like I'm always like, what else is out there? Yeah, okay, that was good. Yeah, yeah, the anthem, okay. Yeah, yeah, oh, that song, yeah, yeah, that's great. I just like exploring. I love creating and I love the process, whether I'm drawing or I'm making an animation or I'm doing a design for a company or I'm writing a worship song for a church or I'm writing a love song to my wife. I just love the exploration. So I don't need it to be successful by somebody else's terms. Because like, that's why I said, like, as a creative entrepreneur, I have 20 different ways I'm like providing for my family by using the gifts I have. So I don't need it. I don't need it for my ego. What my ego needs, but like myself needs, is to like do something new. So when I'm not thinking in terms of, like, I think it's hard because we have this like version of success that's so freaking distorted now and so broken that you have these really dope songs I've heard kids sing, but because they don't get as many views on YouTube or as many likes on something, or, you know, it's not the top of a chart, they feel like it's not valuable. And I'm like, man, we're never going to get great art if those are our metrics. Like, you probably will land on something eventually, but those metrics are kind of a waste of time, you know? And I said it even in my class, it's like they would, like, you know, Dylan and these old folk singers around New York, they'd go from basket house to basket house and they wouldn't ask each other. They would be like, hey, have you heard Jake Hamilton? Like, let's just say, you know, hey, have you heard Jake Hamilton? They would never ask, is he good or what does he sing? Never. They would ask, does he have something to say? And I'm like, dude, where are the people asking that? Dude, so-and-so is releasing a new album. Does he have something to say? Or is it the same thing we've said 1,000 times, but this week it's gospel? Next week it's progressive. Next week it's, you know what I mean? Like, it's like, you know, we're back to like a vineyard style. Yes, we'll just strip everything away and then it'll be new again. It's like, no, do you actually have something to say and offer the planet right now? That to me is my metric of success. Like, if it's honest and authentic to what's actually happening in my life currently, then I'm going to sing it with conviction and I'm going to present it with conviction. And the few people that can relate to it or can connect to it, that's all that matters to me. Doesn't make any difference.
What's the difference between negativity and constructive criticism when receiving feedback on your music?
I think they can be the same thing. It's just more the person who's like, some of us are just too sensitive as artists. Like, I'd rather you tell me it sucks before I go and put it somewhere else. Like, I'd rather hear, I think it's the two parts. Number one, I think we need thicker skin. Like, look, it's a piece of art. If you're only making one and you're like, this is the only thing I've ever made in my whole life. And it's like, well, then probably don't offer it in the same way you'd offer it. Cause when somebody takes shots at it, it's gonna hurt. But if you're like for me, I'm like, I just make stuff. So if you tell me it's not good, I'm like, oh, okay, cool. I'll just make another one. It doesn't really hurt my feelings. So I think we need a little bit more of like engagement in the creative process to start creating more instead of sitting on stuff for so long that it hurts more when it gets hit. And then on the other side, we use the word containment. And containment is sort of like, is this a safe space to be able to bring my art into? So containment means there's a predetermined set of parameters for what I'm about to do so that when you take a shot at it, I'm already prepared because I know that's the reason I'm bringing it here. Does that make sense? So I think a lot of people to go like, dude, check out my song, look. And then it's like, then the person gives constructive criticism, but there was no containment there. There was no space to go, that person really just was excited about something. So just be excited with them. They didn't ask for criticism. They just were excited to share. So we really need the containment of the space to know that I'm showing it for this reason. I need feedback. And we as artists like need to set ourselves up for that. Like, hey, I'm ready to show this. And what are the parameters? Hey, dude, I just need you to be excited. I just finished this. Don't give me your opinion. I just am excited to share it. If we're that self-aware, we'll get less hurt. You know what I mean? And if I bring it to a room and I know I'm going to get criticism, or it's just straight negative because somebody's jealous, doesn't hurt me because I already have containment. I know that's going to happen in this space. But I think most people get hurt or offended or like shut down when there's no containment. It's just, I was trying to show you something and you didn't like it for whatever reason. And then now I'm really, really hurt. You're allowed to be negative towards my music. You don't have to like it. You don't have to like the way I talk. You don't have to like my opinion. You don't have to like my views. But because we do it with so little containment, it feels personal. And then we get hurt. you know? So I think the big way to overcome negativity or criticism in any way, shape, or form is create space for it. Like, who do you want to show this stuff to so that you can get opinions? If that's nobody, I mean, then you're pretty much in danger of getting offended every single time you show someone. But that would be my opinion for artists who want to get like real good feedback. Create space for it. Hey, I need you to take shots at this. Here it is. Now your heart's prepared. They're prepared. They can't say anything that's going to hurt you because you set up the parameters and the containment for that space.
The other question would be how to decide when there is feedback that's just destructive criticism or healthy criticism. How do you decide that for you as an artist? Do you just trust the person that is telling you?
Right. Is it a person that has value in my life? Right. If it's a person on Instagram, what do I care? Like, if you watch like even my feed, it's like, I don't even respond to people that give criticism on anything I do because it's absolutely worthless. I don't know you. I don't need your approval to be me. So if I get triggered by it, it has more to do with my insecurities than it does with that person saying that. It's constructive, regardless of how it comes, if it's someone I trust or value. Like, let's say, I released a song, bunch of people hate it. Jason Upton, who I love, a friend, he goes on Instagram. He's like, dude, it's awesome. I DM'd you some thoughts. Heck yeah. What are those thoughts? You know what I mean? I'd be like, he's like, this part sucks. This part's great. Don't do this, blah, blah, blah. Done. Why? It's Jason Upton. You know what I mean? Like, there's an authority there because of who I believe him to be and what he's done. You know, anybody else? There's like 20 comments of like, the song's crap. This makes sense because I've given him space in my life. Whether I know him or not, I value that. So I'm going to take that and I'm going to learn from it. You know what I mean? So I don't know if that's helpful, but that to me is where if these people have no authority in your life or you value, they don't have any relational connection, it's not even worth listening to most of the time, you know, because they're not seeing you. If they're just seeing the, because a lot of our art gets missed, like art is all subjective, right? So you're seeing it based on who you are and your experience. So you're hearing, I get told a lot, you yell too much. Okay, so am I gonna be quiet for the people who are offended because I'm yelling? Or am I gonna go, no, I'm actually not yelling, I'm actually just really loud and really passionate. But I'm not gonna take the time to explain that to you, it's not worth it. I don't know you. And you're not trying to get to know me, you're just trying to criticize. So that's the difference, I think.
Is receiving affirmation from social media healthy as an artist?
The question isn't whether or not the vehicle or how it arrives to me is healthy. It's what it does for me and how it makes me respond or react that can be the issue. Affirmation is always good. Encouragement is always good. To put courage into another human being is always awesome. But if I'm the one receiving it and I need it for my ego, then I will take that and give myself permission to then chase more affirmation in whatever ways that got me affirmation. And that's way different than someone going, hey, great job. And I go, oh, thanks. I appreciate it. That's great. I love that. I hope that happens for everyone. I hope people on a regular basis feel affirmed in their art and feel, you know, encouraged to step out and do more and try things. But it really has to do with, can I receive that without it feeding ego and then causing me to then repeat what I just did, which is kind of like the question earlier. It's like, is every song now going to be based on the celebration I got for the anthem? Or can I just receive what that is and then pursue where I am now? And that is a different beast. So you're putting your heart out there.
Exactly.
Yeah. But the problem is if you're going to be an artist just in the privacy of your own space, don't do that. You don't have to take any criticism, blah, blah, whatever. the moment I decide I'm going to share it, you have to know that your vulnerability your exposure is going to have shots taken at it. And if you're not ready for that, do not put your art out there. Don't do it, because it's not worth it. It'll be crushing to you, especially if you have tons of mother and father wounds. It's going to be super damaging. It's not even worth it.
Did you know that starting off, or did you?
You learned that. Well, I just wish somebody would have told me, because I'm watching people do this. I'm like, Christian, non-Christian, secular, whatever, all that. It's like everyone's doing it and they don't know they're doing it. I'm watching stuff on Instagram going, you just need mommy to approve. Like, you know, like you're actually not showing this art because you're proud of it. You're actually showing this art because your mom never really gave you the kind of care. It's so obvious at this point that I'm like, I just want to give you a hug. I don't even want to respond to your art. I just want to find you and give you a hug. Because the post itself, or the media that you're putting out there, you're just doing it for likes. You're just doing it for personal affirmation and for ego. It has nothing to do with anything else, you know? But, you know, you can't say that on social media because it's not kind, you know? Like, there are definitely times if they're close enough, I'll be like, hey, saw your post. How are you? Yeah. And dude, I just wish we'd see it as that. And I think, especially for artists, like I'm seeing artists do the same thing, you know? They're performing for affirmation, but it's not art.
What is the main thing for you?
Family. Like, the main thing for me is that every gift and everything that I have in my life, first and foremost, my family benefits from, number one. Like, they have to. It's like, if I don't use my gifts and what, like, very, very practical. So let's make it super practical. You know, I was traveling all over the world, like band and individual. I'd work with bands all over the planet. And I'll never forget one day, I just had a moment with God where he was like, do you want a band or do you want your family? And I'm like, well, duh, like I want my family. So we kind of bailed on everything and just started taking our family around, like traveling with five people, you know, three kids, one of them is in a wheelchair, you know, all over the planet. I could make a lot more money and probably be a lot more like successful financially or exposure wise if I didn't take my family and I just ran all over the planet. I could totally crush it, but they should benefit from what is on my life first. So we travel the planet together and we visit places together and we explore together and we have adventures together as a family and we have stories together as a family, not dad bringing back a story that we all get blessed by. And so they're in it. They're in the meetings or on a platform or in some crazy city we never thought we'd be in before, you know? And to me, that's one way. Another way is I'm writing songs for them. If I'm gonna write for the world, I better be writing for my family. So I write songs for my kids before they were born, like we still sing to this day. You know, they're teenagers and they hate it now, but you know, they each have their own song that I sing over them that declares who they are. And we sing it every single night, you know? And they need to be benefiting from it. And that to me is like, that's part of the authentic conversation, because my life isn't separated into boxes. It's not like, well, family over here, work over here, this over here, that. It's like, no, it's all enmeshed. It's really beautiful and messy and full of tension and it sucks and it's awful. And then it's like really beautiful, you know? And that mess creates some of the best art, you know? That sort of messiness and beauty of all those things make something I would never, but because I can honestly say, my life is deeply connected to my family and those who I claim I love the most. They benefit from this. It's not pulling from them, it's giving to them. And that to me is like the, not just the foundation of what we do, but it is absolutely everything to me as an artist and a writer and a creative. Like, it has to be connected. It cannot be disconnected from my actual life.
Is there a platform that you would decline an invite to?
Oh, interesting. Is there a platform I would decline an invite to? Like, I mean, you're talking to a guy who like went and played a heavy metal fest. I've played heavy metal festivals. I played in clubs in Germany where they're still cleaning blood off the stage from the night before. I've played in like house parties. I say yes to pretty much anything because I like to see what's going to happen. Like I love the idea that we can take our art and we can take our experience with God and our connection to him and put it in random weird places with people who completely don't even agree, let's say, or like have no grid, and we just set it in there and see what happens. Like just put it right in the middle. Like street corners in I'm playing down the street in Varanasi where like you're supposed to get killed for that stuff. You know what I mean? And I'm like screaming down the street, stepping in cow crap everywhere and the whole deal. You know, it was the week of week of the snake or like whatever. I'm like, this is where art really belongs, like to me. Like I'm like, let's take it as far as we can and see what happens. So I've said yes to some wild things and I would continue to do so, I think. Just which cost me a lot. You know what I mean? I didn't show up to a heavy metal festival with my band. I showed up with a drummer and an acoustic guitar and then ran fuzz pedals through it and just said, let's try it. And we'd never done it before. It was like, let's just go for it. And that way I don't know what's going to happen. Like, why should I show up thinking I clearly don't know what happens when I take my music and throw it in the middle of a heavy metal festival. Well, let's just take that to the nth degree. Don't bring a bass player, keyboard player, a second guitarist, just white stripes the thing and see what the heck happens. Dude, kids went nuts because they're like, what in the hell is this? You know? And I will say this. Now, fast forward, same event, because it was run by some people who obviously like had a Christian background. They threw another dude on who came in and tried to just like play some worship songs and preach at people. And they were like, it did not go well. It just did not go well at all. And you're like, wow, that was interesting to watch. Not that I know how to do it perfectly. I have made a million mistakes. It just was interesting to watch like the dichotomy of like, what happens if I try to make it church? It's like, well, what if I just make it a mess? Like most of these kids' lives. Yeah. And they're like, dude, where are you from? Let's hang out. I'm like, heck yeah. So I don't think there's much I would say no to. I've been in some sketch places, so I think there's probably more in the future.
Of course. Is it necessary to categorize an artist as either Christian or secular? For example, Kanye or Bieber.
What's fun about talking about sacred and secular is it completely exposes the dualism in our culture. Like we philosophically, we love dualistic thinking. We need boxes. We want it to be right, wrong, black, white, Democrat, Republican. What are you? Which box are you? Are you, you know, we'll take it super far. You vax, unvax. Are you you're homeschool? You public school. We want to take this down to the most basic human functions and put everything in these dualistic boxes. But life isn't that easy. Like you can't say secular and sacred. It's arrogant at worst and ignorant at best. It's not even a conversation worth having because it takes no account, takes in no account for the person's story. So when we have this conversation, you have to talk about it from two perspectives, the giver and the receiver. So the giver of art, the presenter of art, whatever you want to look at it like, or the person sitting in the audience or the person receiving, social media or in a stadium or wherever. And the person giving, if we're going to talk about secular, sacred, Justin Bieber, Kanye West, whoever else it is, we aren't taking into account their story when we're even having that conversation. And when I say their story, I'm talking about the stuff we don't know about. We're not taking into account any of the reality of who these people are and what they've experienced. We're only doing it as outsiders. And so we're saying that is Jesus. It's not Jesus. That part was, that part's authentic. That part's not, which is all junk, because everything is about the story that you, the story you have. Like, look at it this way. Like, is my daughter, who has cerebral palsy, is 18 years old, in a wheelchair, probably like around 9 years old in terms of like able to grasp things, which I means I have a perpetual little girl forever, which is like stunningly beautiful and really painful, right? Do you honestly think God's gonna judge her as the same standard he's judging me? Is that what he's gonna do? No. Why? Because he's gonna take into account her brokenness. He's gonna take into account her story. I can't do that. I don't have the right to do that. I don't have the ability to do that because I don't see everybody's stories the way God does. He's going to look at my daughter and he's going to give her a different set of expectations than he is me. And when I am looking at someone like Kanye, or I'm looking at someone like a Justin Bieber, I have to take into account, I don't know their story. This may be the most beautiful expression of Christianity that that one story can bring to all of humanity. I don't get that say. It might be totally false and a bunch of crap. I don't get that say. Because I have to recognize that I can't put it in a box because I'm not connected to the story. I mean, look at it this way. We are so committed to dualism that we are throwing massive events, even this weekend, massive events, throwing, spending millions of dollars to make sure people are saved, as if we ever know. It's really to make sure that a bunch of people say yes to the predetermined way you and I, or these people running these events, have said, this is how we know. If they pray the prayer or do the thing, check the box, come to the meeting, go to the church, like, where does it stop? Where does it end? You know, I mean, I'm completely like, I'm the way outsider on this. I'm like, I don't even think you get saved by a prayer. So like, I didn't get married. Like, I got married by walking down the aisle, but my marriage isn't a wedding day. It's a marriage, right? So if I walk down the aisle, but I don't show up 50 years later, then really, did I ever say yes? It's the same thing as like going, if I pray a prayer, but don't show up to the relationship with Christ, like, did I even get saved? I don't know. That's not necessarily what this is for to figure out, but it has a lot to do with the dualistic realities that we keep trying to invite people to, spending millions and millions of dollars to invite people to make sure that we know which box they're in, saved, unsaved. When we know we can spend lots of less money and go to them, which is where Kanye shows up in our story. Dude, like, I went to three Sunday services. I like will never forget the first one I went to. I was in Salt Lake City. It happened to show up. It got announced while I was flying there, and it was walking distance from where I was gonna be. I was like, this is the greatest day ever. It was at Salt Lake City Mall in the middle of like this giant area. And they had set up, they didn't even give anybody notice, dude. Like, the crazy part about these Sunday services is nobody knew it was going on. It was thrown together. It was completely haphazard. Half the stuff doesn't work. The mall barely knows what's going on. 30,000 people descend on a mall, like a literal shopping mall. People are sitting on top of three-story buildings just to get a look, to get a look at people singing the gospel. Like, I wept and wept and wept because I was like, that's it. Like, this is what I've been waiting to see my whole, like, Christian adult life. He's going to malls and going to the center of he's going to the city square. And he doesn't even get on stage for more than 5 minutes. It was insane. He literally just stands on the side like this the whole time. Doesn't even get up. Then after the guy preached, which he preached 1 Corinthians 13, what does love look like? He preached for all of 10 minutes and then was like, hey, does anybody want to know Jesus? Dude, 5,000, 6,000 people are like, I'm in. Sign me up. Dude, completely haphazard, no promotion, not millions of dollars, just showing up in the middle of the square and then doing what you do. Then Kanye gets up for literally, I think he was up for 10 minutes. It was 2 hours long. And homie gets up for 10 minutes. I'm like, that to me is, I mean, I have like loads of opinions on this stuff, but I'm like, that to me was one of the greatest expressions of modern day evangelism I think I've ever seen. And I've been a guy who's been a part of stadiums. I've been a guy who's on the streets. I've been the guy doing all these things. I've done it all. That to me, I was like, that was one of the most beautiful expressions of modern day evangelism I have ever seen.
God brought love into the world through his son, Jesus Christ.
This, like, most of my Christian friends are going to miss this. They're never going to get to preach to these people. I was in Arizona. I opened for Kanye at Sun Devil Stadium in January of 2020, like with, you know, Eddie James. I met Kanye. We met the whole Sunday service crew. We played, Eddie James played, and then Kanye played. Dude, that place cleared out after Kanye was done. Why? Because they were there to see a man in process. I think we're all watching because we want to see the process. We don't need the product. If we can be voyeurs to another man's process, dude, we're in. And I think that's why a lot of artists, the best thing you can do is let people be a voyeur to your art while it's still in process, while it's still broken and fractured, because then we don't have to determine whether or not it's secular or sacred. We can just enjoy the process together and see what comes out of humility and tenderness and vulnerability in a way that most of us never even get to experience in our own personal lives.
What does a normal day look like for Jake Hamilton?
Normal day for Jake Hamilton. I won't tell you what my mornings look like because those are private, but I will tell you I get up at 5 and I like have my time. And then I take the kids to school. I help my wife get the kids to school. Usually have coffee with my wife in the morning. And then I will jump into work. I have music that I do, but I also have a design business, animation, motion graphics, branding, logo design, all that stuff. So I've been doing that for a while. So I'll jump into some of those projects, as well as then planning some of the travel stuff that we have coming up. So I kind of juggle everything and try to stay ahead on a lot of that stuff. And then in the midst of that, I'll go, you know, like, it depends on what the kids need in that day, you know? So I basically just juggle projects for the day based on what the need is for the family. So me and my wife check in the morning after the kids are in school. What do you have? Okay, where can I help? Okay, I'll get dinner ready. You're going to go work out at 4:30. I'll take care of dinner. You'll get home. Then I have this thing. But I try to wrap most nights outside of Monday night man talks that I do for like a Zoom thing and my Wednesday night men's stuff. I usually am done check out by 5. So like 5:30, I'm done. So that way I'm present the rest of the evening with kids and family and all that stuff. But it's pretty much a juggle. It's not a consistent look. I try to keep my mornings consistent for my own personal stuff. I try to take the kids to school with my wife like pretty consistently. And then that whole middle section is like, depends on the project, the week, or whatever I'm doing. Like, did I travel in 2 weeks? Do I have an event coming up? And then I have to book stuff and do all that. But most of the time, it's like that afternoon chunk. While the kids are at school, I'm grinding and getting work done. So, you know, 6 to 8 hour day, like most normal people. But I'm working. Like that's, again, I go back to my statement. Like, if you can be as talented as you want, if you're not putting in the work, like, don't tell me you're a songwriter if you don't write a song every day. Then you're not a songwriter. You're a tourist. And that's cool. You can be a tourist. Write a couple songs. It's cool. But don't tell me you're a songwriter and you write once a week. If you're not writing a chorus a day and you're a songwriter and you're telling me you're a songwriter, you're just a liar. That's not true. You got to be putting in the work every single day. You're building muscles, you know? That's the way it works.
I'll give a little bit of premise for this one. Kim Walker, you mentioned her a little while ago. She was probably like the first for me, and I think everybody that I know, the first viral worship leader.
Oh, yeah. Oh, heck yeah.
And oh, how he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us so.
Raw. Organic, in the moment, how he loves, blew up all over the place. And then fast forward over a decade later, here's my question. Has worship moments become too commercialized?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. You know, Kim, so here's the background, which I don't even know if I'm allowed. You might want to check what I'm allowed to share. But Kim hated that part. Okay, so question back to you. Which part meant the most to you hearing her sing How She Loves?
The part where she broke down the song.
His presence, his love is so thick and tangible in this room tonight. And there are some of you here that have not encountered the love of God.
She began to weep. It's like, and his love is blowing. Oh, you know, like the whole thing.
If you haven't encountered the love of God, and you would know, because you wouldn't be the same. You would never be the same again. And if you want to encounter the love of God right now, you better just brace yourself, because he's about to just blow in this place.
She hated that part and tried to get it out of the song. She wept when Banning told her they were leaving it in. Why? Because it was so authentically her. We're not crying over those moments now. We're like, hell yeah, this is going to get hits. That's going to get views. She's weeping because it was like so, it was almost embarrassing to her because it was so vulnerable.
He loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves me.
Where are those moments? We film everything now, man. We've turned it all into one big, stupid commercial for our own egos. But we said Jesus, so it must be about God. I'm sorry. I'm the outlier. Like, I don't want to see your shoe collection, man. Like, I don't want to see your hype beast clothes and your stupid house. Like, I want to see real lives grinding it out when it means nothing and doesn't get you a Grammy. Like, those are the things that mean the world to me. Because I'm impressed by that. I guess that's probably better language. I'm probably a total jerk and whatever. To me, what impresses me is the kid who's doing it and doesn't get anything for it. I'm impressed by the guy who's working 60 hours a week and leads worship at his local church that nobody knows about. And he's writing dope songs. And they'll never be recorded and he'll never be celebrated. That impresses me. Like, and the fact that we don't celebrate those things, like, and we don't have a space to just honor that, like, it's no wonder people are falling into all types of sin in the church, because we're just building freaking idols to our ego, and then wonder why it doesn't work out. And I'm not saying everybody's that way and blah, blah, blah. I'm making very broad strokes and tons of assumption that can go back to what I said earlier, which is I'm not taking into account people's stories. So I totally get that. But I'm also looking at 16-year-olds who feel like crap writing songs because they're not getting the same recognition. And they're trying to ask me how to get freaking famous. Screw that. Like, I'm not going to be a part of that. I refuse to do it. And I don't care what that looks like on the outside. I refuse to do that. I refuse to partake in it, and I'm not going to celebrate it as that's the model. That's what success looks like. And I think some of these people are really great people. I've met a lot of them. But it's now we're looking. I mean, we're now we're looking for moments instead of just letting moments happen. Because that stuff takes time. And it takes tons of vulnerability, you know? Why do you think it happened way more years ago? Because people weren't interested in how it looks. They just really loved Jesus and weren't afraid to put that thing on display. And I'll end with this, I guess, is like, I mean, I'll never forget years ago, a guy was talking about worship leading in a small circle of us. And he said, you know, the closest secular equivalent to being a worship leader? He said, it's a porn star. He said, both take their most intimate acts, put them on display for money, hoping to arouse others to do the same. And I was like, wow, that hurts. And it should. Because if it hurts me, then I can do something about it. I can be honest about it in my own life. Where am I doing that? Where in my life am I doing that currently? And where? How can I be honest and authentic, repent in that space, and then make room for something better, which I think is family and community and relationship, tons of which will never be filmed, never be on tape, never be celebrated, but heaven freaking goes nuts over it.
Hey, production gurus, if you like that video and you want to see more, click that subscribe button.